But let's quickly take a look at Tomoya's accomplishments here.
Tomoya was able to secure top six at the Japan Nationals this year to be able to secure his invite at the World Championships. And when you take a look at how he's also performed in these online circuits, that's a Global Challenge top four as well. That is so impressive when you think about how many different players that you were able to play against to even get to the point where you're playing in Japan Nationals.
Absolutely. So recapping his team, it's going to be Zapdos, Dark Urshifu, Sylveon, Gastrodon, Hisuian, Arcanine, and Rillaboom. He said it himself, it's kind of a weird team, and a lot of these Pokemon have unique sets. For example, this Rillaboom is Ghost Terra Leftovers. It does not have Wood Hammer. It's got Drum Beating, U-Turn, Fake Out, and Protect. Sylveon is a Choice Spec set. It's got Hyper Beam, Terra Blast, Hyper Voice, and Sleep Talk. You've got Hisuian Arcanine with Assault Vest, Fairy Terra, Terra Blast as well. Something that I think is fairly interesting. Gastrodon here is a Rocky Helmet set with Earth Power, Ice Beam, Yawn, and Protect. Zapdos is bulky. It's got that Citrus Berry. It's got that Roost and Tailwind combination as well. And as we mentioned earlier, Poison, Dark Urshifu with that Black Glasses.
A Black Glass is a very interesting tech to be able to have on this team, just to be able to boost up all of those Dark-type attacks. But how is it going to fare against his opponent? Robbie on the other side did get a top eight at the North America International Championships this year, as well as also a back-to-back top eight when you look at how he did at the European International Championships too.
This is actually Robbie's first full season of playing competitively. So for him to have made it to the World Championship Finals is so impressive, especially after losing the top eight of those last two internationals. Now he has the chance to claim his very first major title, and he's got a really strong team to support that. We already started talking about it a little bit earlier. My eyes are definitely drawn to that Assault Vest Heatran. Now, this Heatran has the Heavy Slam, which we mentioned. Heavy Slam, I think, can be really interesting here, especially with Fairy Terras on the opposing side as well. And it just does large amounts of damage to something like Sylveon. Grass Terra Heatran, just one of the safest combos in terms of Terra in this format. And Robbie just has a lot of offense. You've got the Tornadus to set up the Sunny Day. You've got the Choice Specs Fluttermane. You've got Heatran. The Landorus Therian here, pretty interesting, by the way. It actually has a Citrus Berry on it.
That is very interesting indeed. When you look at how Landorus has usually been used for some of these, you know, more recent formats, you take a look at maybe something like a Choice Scarf or an Assault Vest to really be able to help out that Landorus do its job more effectively. But the Citrus Berry does give it a little bit of wiggle room when it comes down to how much damage it can take and how well you can actually use it as a pivoting tool to cycle those Intimidates.
I think both trainers have a lot of tools at their disposal. Coming into this matchup, what I'm looking at is, where's the offense really coming from? I think from Robbie's end, the Fluttermane and the Heatran look really, really powerful. Fluttermane, I think, is going to force Tomoya to potentially go for a defensive Terra, like that Poison Terra on Urshifu, for example. Or you have to figure out how to basically weave in Hisuian Arcanine to not just let Fairy-type attacks run over you. For example, I think if you go with, like, Zapdos, Urshifu, Sylveon, and Gastrodon, and you don't bring the Hisuian Arcanine, Fairy-type attacks obviously do a lot of damage, and the only way you can really get around it is, of course, that Dark Urshifu. Dark Urshifu here, however, while it's Poison Terra, it doesn't have something like a Poison Jab, and so, of course, you can go for Wicked Blow onto Fluttermane, but if Fluttermane on the other side goes for that Fairy Terra, you might not actually get that one-hit knockout anymore with Wicked Blow, so that's something to keep in mind as well. Of course, you can then just follow it up with a Sucker Punch, but I think that's one thing to pay attention to. How can Robbie utilize Fluttermane specifically to really just do massive amounts of damage and potentially force out a Terra? And then I think Heatran also just really difficult to deal with, quite frankly. It is very, very bulky, and there are so many special attackers on Tomoya's side.
I could totally see Robbie going for a more aggressive angle, leading with a Tornadus, going with a Fluttermane as a great duo to be able to take advantage of something like the speed or the Sunny Day to get that Protosynthesis boost right away. We'll have to wait and see exactly what Proto boost it's going to provide over. But I'm also looking at, you could also lead the Heatran. Quite honestly, just go ahead and lead with that and start to get it ready to go.
Yeah, definitely. I think one of the things here is kind of figuring out, who do I want to Terra? If you go for Grass Terra and Heatran, it's generally pretty safe. It does now open some new weaknesses. For example, the Zapdos can click Hurricane onto the Heatran. You can, of course, get hit by Ice Beam from Gastrodon. One thing that I think would be really funny is Gastrodon versus Heatran, right? Because you're like, okay, Gastrodon should just beat Heatran. But then Heatran's like, okay, I'm going to go for Grass Terra, and now I'm going to go for Terra Blast. And then Gastrodon's like, well, I'm just going to Fairy Terra you. What are you going to do now? But then Heatran's like, I have Heavy Slam for your Fairy Terra. So I think this whole dynamic is just really interesting between those two specific Pokemon. And one other thing I'm curious about is just whether or not Gastrodon and Urshifu actually come out, right? Normally, you want to bring Gastrodon just to make sure that Water Urshifu on the opposing side can't just freely click Surging Strikes. But Gastrodon can sometimes feel like dead weight, especially when Fluttermane has a Choice Specs, has that Fairy Terra Moonblast on the opposing side, and you're up against this Heatran with that Grass Terra Terra Blast.
That is definitely a way to put that Heatran into a sticky position, though, and that's where, the Zapdos can come into play, absolutely, to try to be able to deal with that. So we're looking at the defensive Terra timing here coming out from Tomoya and how Robbie can kind of take advantage of that to be able to get himself into a good position. But likewise, for the Terra timing on Robbie's side, you want to make sure you don't get pinned down when you use that Terra.
Yeah, I think one thing I'm really paying attention to is we were talking about Fluttermane and Heatran on Robbie's side earlier. So for Fluttermane, for example, right, sometimes you might just want to go for Fairy Terra immediately, start clicking Moonblast or Dazzling Gleam. If Tomoya does not lead properly against that, that can just start dealing massive amounts of damage. So then my question is, okay, how does Tomoya actually respond to something like Fairy Terra Fluttermane? It starts with something like Hisuian Arcanine. You could even potentially lead that immediately just to make Fluttermane struggle a little bit more. Or that Poison Urshifu, right? If with Poison Urshifu, you can go for that Poison Terra immediately, then Wicked Blow into Fluttermane. So one of the things I'm mainly curious about is, do we see Fluttermane come out immediately and just start dealing large amounts of damage, or does Robbie use it to maybe bait out a defensive Terra slash switch early on, switch out the Fluttermane, and then bring it out in the late game and try to sweep with it?
What about Landorus?
Landorus is definitely an interesting one as well. Of course, the Citrus Berry set here, so it's not like Assault Vest. It will take a little bit more damage from these special attackers. Intimidate, though, very valuable, very good specifically into Hisuian Arcanine, right? You're like, okay, well, hey, if you're going to use the Hisuian Arcanine to counter my Fluttermane, I'll just bring out Landorus and I'll just go for a Stomping Tantrum onto you. So it's really interesting because it's like, you have some defensive options that maybe cover for the Fluttermane, but then Landorus can go for example, Flying Terra Blast onto Urshifu or that Stomping Tantrum into Hisuian Arcanine.
So many different possibilities of how this match can play out, and that's exactly why it is so dynamic for how these two trainers can match up against each other. And so we'll have to wait and see what's going to be happening as we start to load into this first game. It is a best of three to be able to decide it all, who will be our senior division world champion. And it's going to be kicking off so soon. I can't wait to see what the leads are going to be.
What Pokemon do you want to see come out immediately, Rosemary?
I want to see the Tornadus and the Fluttermane, but my heart says I want to see the Sylveon coming out from Tomoya.
Sylveon, I think, would be really, really cool. It's actually something that I'm really curious about, because if you're able to bait out the Grass Terra from Heatran, then Hyper Voice actually becomes a lot more effective in sweeping. I think the other question I have is, do we see Amoongus come out from Robbie's end? I think it makes sense for Robbie to have it in the back. You could go a mode with like Tornadus, Flutter, Heatran, Amoongus, for example, and then switch Flutter out into Amoongus early on, bait out those Terras, put things to sleep, and then sweep with Flutter and Heatran. But here we go, game one of the Senior Division World Championships, and there's Tornadus and Flutter. You called it, Rose.
And there's, the
there's Arcanine and Sylveon.
Oh my gosh. We've got both of the fairy types on the field to be able to kick off this first game. And the Hisuian Arcanine is going to put a ton of pressure down onto the Tornadus. And the Fluttermane's not going to be able to hit it very well.
Yeah, this is so interesting because right now you can go for Fairy Terra with Fluttermane, maybe go for like Sunny Day, Moonblast into the Sylveon. But Arcanine really in a good position against the Tornadus and Fluttermane. This is an excellent lead to specifically cover for Fluttermane. And Fluttermane is choice specs, right? So it's like you either just switch out, which is what Robbie's doing, or you kind of just accept you're going to take a lot of damage. But this means Sylveon can get a Hyper Voice, but there's that Heatran. That's an excellent switch in right now.
Fantastic to be able to deal with the opposing side. It's going to be a great defensive Pokemon to try to take some of these hits, but it's going to be the Rock Slide, and that's going to deal super effective damage onto the Tornadus, and the Hyper Voice to follow it up does take out the Torn. However, Robbie now has a unique opportunity to be able to bring in something else right under that Tailwind.
Yeah, one thing to note here is that Hisuian Arcanine does not have close combat, which it sometimes carries. So Landorus now hits the field, is able to go for an Intimidate, not valuable into the Sylveon, but of course quite good into the Hisuian Arcanine, and Tailwind is set up. The Sylveon here, of course, is locked into that Choice Specs Hyper Voice, right? So it's Fire Terra. You could, of course, get around the super effective hit from the Heavy Slam with the Fire Terra, but one play you could make on the opposing side is just go for Stomping Tantrum and Heavy Slam, which would cover for that Terra if it goes into fire. Then the question is, does Sylveon potentially consider switching out? Let's say Zapdos is in the back. That would be really helpful, but it's going to be Arcanine pivoting out first.
So Arcanine going to go ahead and take a little bit of a reprieve as the Gastrodon now is going to be able to hit the field. And whoa, it's a double switch here on this turn. And so we'll see
there's
that fourth
the
and final in that Zapdos. What a great switch.
So the question now is, what is going into that slot? It's going to be Stomping
Tantrum
into Zapdos.
The flying type is going to be able to keep
slam.
It safe.
That's exactly what we were talking about.
Great coverage from the
static. Are you kidding me?
What a turn! What a turn for Tomoya to be able to read that switch, read those calls, and bring in the Zapdos at the perfect time.
The crowd goes absolutely wild right now. Gastrodon in a really interesting position. Of course, it has that Ice Beam into Landorus. It has that Earth Power into Heatran. You, of course, have to worry about the Landorus now going for Stomping Tantrum onto the Gastrodon slot. This Heatran, of course, is that Grass Terra as well. So you could Grass Terra, Terra Blast here. One play I think you could make is honestly just protect Gastrodon right now and set up a Tailwind with Zapdos, maybe even just Thunderbolt into the Heatran. Right now, you have an early lead on Tomoya's end, right? So it's like trying to bait out a Terra, see what Robbie's going to do, install out that Tailwind, but an amazing first two turns.
And Fluttermane's going to come back in, just try to get some Intimidate cycles, keep that Landorus a little bit safe. But Zapdos has a great opportunity to go for the Tailwind to now stagger being able to have that speed control.
Oh, and the Heat Wave misses the Zapdos.
That's a huge miss on that Heat
Wave. No, Terra's, it's just Earth Power. It's going to be Yawn. Okay, so putting on some pressure onto the Fluttermane. I really like the Yawn, honestly, because Fluttermane right now feels like it exerts a lot of offensive pressure, right? But if you decide to actually attack this turn, you're going to fall asleep. And Gastrodon could so easily protect right now. So Tomoya here could make it a prediction, right? And say, okay, well, I think you're just go back into Landorus. You haven't Terra'd. I can just Ice Beam into that slot. So this is really critical, right? Does Robbie say, I don't think you're going to play safely. I'm going to go for a Fairy Terra and just Moonblast you here immediately. Or does he make the safe defensive pivot into Landorus? If he does that, does Tomoya call it? The other thing is we didn't see a Terra come up from either end right now. So there is a threat still of that Grass Terra, Terra Blast on a Gastrodon as well.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think there's a few Pokemon in the back that would not mind taking that too poorly. As we also look at, there's no Urshifu coming to this game. We've been able to reveal all four Pokemon on both sides.
Oh, no switch, no switch, okay.
And there is no switch on the board. So let's see what is gonna take that Terrastalization. And it is the Fluttermane. We'll be getting that Fairy Terra type, be able to boost up something like a Dazzling Gleam, a Moonblast, just take a few of these hits just a little bit better.
Does Gastrodon protect? It does protect. Goes for the safe play. And with Fluttermane not switching out, it's going to fall asleep after this turn. Robbie tries to play aggressively. Tomoya calls it. Plays safely. Gets the protect. And he's going to be in such an incredible position.
Oh, the Hurricane hits
as well. Just a little bit depth damage on a Fluttermane. But critically, Fluttermane's going to fall asleep right now. Tomoya is playing lights out in this very first game of the World Championship Finals. And Heatwave misses Zapdos too, just adding insult to injury.
That is such a great turn. And now you said two turns got called completely right. It's going to be a third added to that stamp card. And we will have to see how Robbie's going to respond to this. But as it stands, Tomoya has hit up the Tailwind just a few turns later. Will get the speed control in his favor once Robbie's Tailwind expires. And this Fluttermane is asleep.
Yeah, I think for Robbie right now, if you want to mount a comeback, you have to make basically the perfect switch each turn, right? You don't have Terra anymore, so the Heatran, of course, is left exposed to a potential Earth Power. It's going to be Fluttermane making the switch, though. Another thing that's critical is now the Heatran just doesn't really threaten Gastrodon, so you don't really need to consider a Terra on that anymore.
But wait, after the Intimidate drop, what kind of attack did Tomoya go for?
Oh, it's Thunderbolt.
Okay,
into the Landorus, okay.
Great switch there from Robbie to
and
not take that.
And the Earth Power into the Heatran, super effective.
What?
Does not care about the Assault Vest. Heatran is now down. This Landorus can't even go for a Terra, so of course you can bring Fluttermane back out, but Fluttermane can't protect. It has to take a turn of sleep. You can very easily double up onto that slot with the Thunderbolt and an Earth Power. Try to just get the knockout onto that, and then Gastrodon just wins 1v1 against the Landorus. Tomoya, the defensive plays, the aggression onto Tornadus in the early game, and calling multiple turns to really just stall out this Tailwind. Really beautiful play by him so far.
It has been amazing, and this Landorus won't be able to do too much to the Zapdos on the other side. It is not carrying anything like a Rock Slide, and so the Thunderbolt into the Fluttermane, that's going to be the first attack, and it's just a critical hit. Gastrodon doesn't even need to follow that up.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised to see the Earth Power here just to really play it safe, guarantee the knockout onto that slot. We saw a couple of Heatwave misses. There's the Earth Power. We saw a couple of Heatwave misses earlier and the critical hit, but I honestly don't think any of those impacted this game. The main thing is if you had hit that Heatwave earlier, maybe then you would think about more going for like a Moonblast onto Zapdos, for example. But I think in this game, there was just a huge lead, and Tomoya answered the Fluttermane perfectly, right? It's like if I have lead Arcanine and Sylveon, the Fluttermane is put into a really awkward position. So Tomoya is going to go up one game in this World Championship Finals, and I can't wait to see what lead adjustment Robbie makes here.
The lead looks so good as well. So much offensive pressure coming in from the Tornadus and the Fluttermane. But at the very beginning of that game number one, Tomoya called it. You could see that in the leads that he ended up bringing with the Arcanine and the Sylveon and the Rock Slide to be able to catch the Heatran on the income and just be able to follow that up with even more spread damage from the Sylveon was perfect.
So my question now going into this next game is, okay, you saw this lead of Hisui and Arcanine and Sylveon that felt so specifically designed to counter this Tornadus Fluttermane combination. So how do you now counter that? Do you think Tomoya will go back to it? Because if so, there are multiple answers to this combination, right? For example, you can look towards that Landorus Therian form. That puts on a lot of pressure onto Arcanine immediately. You can look towards leading Heatran immediately, right? We saw Heatran switch in earlier in the battle, but if you just bring out it immediately, you have that Heavy Slam pressure onto Sylveon, you have that Earth Power pressure into Arcanine, you can just go for Heat Waves if you think, for example, it's gonna switch out into Zapdos as well. So I think where this next game I'm really looking at is the leads, because I felt like Tomoya had a huge, huge advantage from the leads in game one and was just able to execute perfectly even after the leads.
I agree, but every single turn you saw those switches just be able to read what Robbie was going to be doing with his own Pokemon, working around those attacks, and now Robbie is going to be a little bit back against the wall, has to be able to bring it back in this next game, but Tomoya is one game away from being able to take the victory, and I'm sure he can taste it.
Oh my goodness, that first game was just absolutely wild. So cool to see that Sylveon, which we were talking about. And the reason why I think Sylveon is a really smart brain with the Hisuian Arcanine in particular is because, yeah, like Hyper Voice doesn't really do anything into the Heatran, but it still does so much damage into everything else. And a single Hyper Voice can really just snowball the game. So love this offensive lead from Tomoya to put on so much pressure. The Tailwind really didn't feel super relevant in that game either. And we did see the Paralysis on the Heatran previously as well. But in the grand scheme of things, I think, you know, I really respect the play Robbie was trying to go for, because I do think some players would play really aggressively, go for that Ice Beam into the Flutter main slot, expecting it to switch into Landorus. And I think if Robbie gets that turn correctly, that last game actually looks really differently. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think definitely can give him credit for trying to make that prediction, but we'll have to see what lead adjustment he goes with. And I'm looking at Landorus and Heatran maybe more as an early game lead. I think Amoongus didn't come out in that previous game. The awkward thing about Amoongus here is that it's the Dark Terra Amoongus. So if you go for Dark Terra, well, then you're suddenly weak to Hyper Voice from Sylveon. And so not sure that's the best answer into the Arcanine Sylveon lead specifically. There is also the Water Urshifu, which is quite good and can put on a lot of offensive pressure. But do you really feel comfortable bringing that into a matchup with Gastrodon? I personally wouldn't.
No, I think that's why we ended up seeing both of the Urshifu stay at home in that game number one. Non-factor, maybe that changes heading into game number two, but do we see that Heatran adjustment coming out from Robbie right away? Let's go ahead and find out as we jump into game two of the Seniors Division World Championship Finals.
There it is.
And there's the Heatran and the Landorus from Robbie, and we'll see the Gastrodon
and Sylveon.
Tomoya
says, I'm not going to go with the same thing again. There's no way you go with Tornadus plus Fluttermane. If Torn and Fluttermane had actually been led here, it would actually be a lot more awkward for Tomoya. But Tomoya expects the adjustment, brings that Sylveon with the Gastrodon this time around, and Gastrodon so well positioned into a Landorus plus Heatran. You can Ice Beam the Landorus slot. You can Earth Power Heatran. However, you still have to dance this awkward battle of where is Heatran going to target. It has that Grass Terra, Terra Blast. So I think from Tomoya's side right now, you really want to bait out a Terra and see if the Heatran actually commits to it. And the other thing is, who do you Terra, right? Do you Terra the Gastrodon defensively? Do you Terra Sylveon? The thing is, if you Terra either of these Pokemon, they suddenly become weak to other attacks that Landorus and Heatran carry.
Exactly. So maybe we do end up seeing some sort of pivot, or you just lean into the Terra right away. Either choice.
Okay, no Terra. Okay, we're just going
no
for damage. Whoa.
That's a stomping tantrum into the Gastrodon, and the Landorus is going to have to take a little bit of
But misses.
Gastrodon. Sylveon is still going to take a huge chunk, though, from that critical hit, but a Hyper Voice in return. Landorus is also going to get taken down so low, but there is that Citrus Berry coming in clutch for a little bit of that HP recovery. And let's see, Gastrodon going for the Earth Power into the Heatran. No, Terra does not keep it super safe, and that is a low Heatran now.
So I think Robbie here learning from the previous game, he split his damage in this one, but it makes a lot of sense because in game one, we saw the Sylveon pivot out into Zapdos and just soak up so much damage. So in this end, Robbie's just looking for guaranteed free damage onto both slots, saying, hey, at least I know I am faster with my Pokemon right now. Very interesting to see no Terra on either end, right? Both players actually just kind of trade damage. Gastrodon's still looking fairly healthy. So now the question is, do you really feel comfortable tearing Landorus or Heatran? They're both such low health at this point. Sylveon still in an awkward spot. So it's like, do you want to consider switching that into Zapdos, protecting Gastrodon, for example? Curious if Zapdos is even in the back, but it does feel like a really consistent bring to cover for that Landorus.
Zapdos might also be the perfect response, too, if you expect something like an Earth Power to come out. But it is going to be the Fluttermane switch in for Robbie. as we're going to preserve that Heatran for later.
No, but
the stopping Tantrum is just going to go into the
Sylveon.
My goodness! The survival is huge! Hyper Voice in response, and Landorus is down for the count.
3 HP on this Sylveon. It gets so much damage. There's Earth Power onto Fluttermane. Oh, but Fluttermane
so
does survive.
Close. That Sylveon sure does love its trainers. It's going to be able to hold on. And as we do see the Amoongus now, nice adjustment from Robbie to be able to slow down the pace of this game.
Oh, but there's so much damage. And that Sylveon, that's what I mean. Every single Hyper Voice puts in so much work. Fluttermane does critically survive that. I feel like if Fluttermane faints there, the game is just over immediately. But the awkward thing right now is like, who do you terror at this point? Fluttermane is at 9 HP, right? Amoongus, it could terror, but then it's weak to Hyper Voice. I mean, Fluttermane right now can go for like Fairy Terror and just go for like a Dazzling Gleam, but looks like it's just gonna try to not terror and just get a free attack right now.
Yeah, that Amoongus is actually critically running that Leaf Storm. So a nice way to be able to protect itself as the Gastrodon does go for that. Sylveon is just going to go down in this turn, but it has put in so much work in this game number two that it deserves a little bit of a rest there.
Absolutely. The main question I have is what's pivoting in? By the way, this Amoongus does have Leaf Storm, so it actually has a way to deal significant damage and knock out the Gastrodon, but there's that Arcanine. That's the perfect Pokemon to bring out right now. Does not care for the Dazzling Gleams from the Fluttermane. Pressures Amoongus with the super effective Flare Blitz. So now the question is, do you just give up your Fluttermane and play towards a Landorus endgame? I think that's what I would personally do.
I think you have to at this point, especially knowing that the Landorus also could Terastallize there. You have to Terra Blast for a little bit later if you want to be able to try to put that specific type of damage down. But it's going to be a Dazzling Gleam. So Gastrodon, Arcanine, just taking a little bit of chip here as the Arcanine is going to be able to Rock Slide in response.
Oh.
It does get the knockout onto the Fluttermane, but is the Amoongus going to even be able to
move? Does it flinch? Just the question right now. First Ice Beam coming out. That's also a lot of damage. Doesn't get the knockout.
Doesn't get the knockout.
Okay,
it is a crit.
It's a critical
hit.
That's
a lot of damage. But Amoongus is going to use the Spore into the Arcanine, putting it to sleep.
Oh my goodness, this is so tense. One thing to note though is that this Amoongus does not have Pollen Puff. So unlike some traditional Amoonguses, you can't just consistently heal up. And so yeah, there's the Heatran just coming back out into this battle. But oh, the Pokemon are just at such low HP right now.
This is a nice position to be in though, because you do have the Heatran out. It could go for something like the Terra Grass, Terra Blast to be able to pick up the Gastrodon. Arcanine is asleep, so there are a few turns that Robbie has bought himself to be able to get back into this game.
Yeah, definitely. You're at least in a position where you can put on pressure onto both slots. For example, the Heatran here can just go for Grass, Terra, Terra Blast onto Gastrodon, right? But the question is now you're playing around when does the Arcanine manage to wake up? And there's the Grass, Terra coming out.
I think you just have to go for it, though. Especially when Tomoya is in just a little bit of a better position heading into the later parts of this game, knowing that we do still have that one and final Pokemon in the back. Arcanine taking its mandatory turn of sleep. It's going to have to get through that as
heat
the
wave.
Heat Wave comes out now.
Oh,
Arcanine's going to avoid
that. I don't
think
that KOs. Gastrodon survives. That
it's
means,
just a sliver of
storm.
HP.
It's the Arcanine sled. That means Gastrodon gets an attack off. It should get a knockout here if it goes for Ice Beam. It's Antley Amoongus, that's down. It's a 3v1 now. And I don't see how Robbie can win this anymore.
Heatran is going to be the final Pokemon left for Robbie. As the Gastrodon, the Arcanine, there's still that fourth in the back. It's going to be the Sylveon that did get, like, that was going to be a huge amount of pressure there. But the battle is just canceled. And Tomoya Ogawa is your Seniors Division World Champion in Japan.